In the archive are several thick scrapbooks in which Solzhenitsyn entered, often literally paced, his impressions written down on small pages from a notepad. Here is a notebook on travels. There are scrapbooks of musical impressions and meetings he had during his life, and separately one about meetings with literary people, with writers. A great number of outlines on philosophy, history, literature, and language have been preserved. Here is one of four summaries on philosophy from a handmade notebook at the Sharashka prison, 1947. A special place in the archive is taken up by the products of Solzhenitsyn's 40 years of work of the Dictionary of Russian Language Expansion. This dictionary has been published many times now in Russia. He compiled this dictionary in self-made notepads. Just a few, what to do? I can't do it. Хорошо. He compiled his dictionary in self-made notepad, just a few of which are shown here, containing extracts from Dal dictionary. The scrap card catalog of the Red Wheel is an element of the archive unlike any other. Alexander Isaevich conceived of the idea of a historical epic about the Russian Revolution as a teenager, aged 18. And throughout his life, he gathered episodes, anecdotes, facts, chronologies, available materials, observations, judgments, thoughts. When, in 1967, the volume of this material began to grow at a rapid pace, Solzhenitsyn designed a plan for a catalog, or rather a series of interconnected catalogs, which allowed him to functionally group the material that was coming in, often chaotically. He placed the scraps of materials in his card catalog in self-made envelopes made out of thick paper of different colors and sizes. Hence, color and size became an aspect of the system. "I will end up with thousands of little sheets," Solzhenitsyn wrote. "So without this system, I'd be lost. The pace and success of such a broad opus depend on the right organization of hundreds and thousands of little sheets of paper. There are 285 envelopes and folders in this catalog." Here was a black and gray card catalogs, materials about historical and functional characters, respectively. The largest section of the catalog is the multicolored one, in which materials are sorted by theme and topic. And here is a view of the contents inside just one of the envelope at this catalog, titled "The Land, Rural Villages." The smallest envelopes, just palm size, included a collection the author entitled "Eyes Open," with subdivisions such as living faces, sketch portraits, old people, young men, girls, as well as birds, fish, trees, etc. Finally, there is a catalog of ideas and plots where the material was grouped by nodal point chronologically. Quote, "I doubt I could have completed such a work without a methodical, systemic approach, which is part of my character, and without a mathematical way of thinking, which I was taught," unquote. This whole unique catalog and its content are not just auxiliary or preparatory materials left over in the writer's workshop. They are, in a sense, a separate creation by Solzhenitsyn. Solzhenitsyn's correspondence is vast. With rare exceptions, its publication has not yet begun. This collection can roughly be divided into three parts. The personal correspondence is letters to and from relatives and close friends. There are many hundreds of such letters, and their number keeps growing as children and grandchildren of those who corresponded with Solzhenitsyn give us letters by him that they have preserved. Here, for example, is a highly valuable letter in terms of the information it contains, written by Solzhenitsyn during internal exile in 1953 to a friend of his mother, Maria Kremer. Solzhenitsyn's mother died in 1944 while he was at the front. His wife married another man, and he describes in this letter everything that happened in his life since his youth. Here you see two of the four pages. Solzhenitsyn's literary correspondence contains mainly his exchanges of letters and with writers and readers. The most notable of these is a correspondence with Lydia Korneyevna Chukovskaya, which lasted many years and numbers more than 100 letters. Here is one of the letters from Alexander Isaevich to Lydia Korneyevna. This entire correspondence will be published in the coming years. There is also a huge general correspondence from the 1962 to 2008. It was systemized by Solzhenitsyn himself, who broke it down into more than 450 sections and folders. The archive numbers tens of thousands of such letters. Intact documents concerning Solzhenitsyn's parents. Here, for example, is his father's birth certificate. Certificate of completion of courses for translators issued to the pupil Solzhenitsyn. Diploma with honors for completion of the physics and mathematics faculty of Rostov University. Military ID issued to Sound Ranging Reconnaissance Battery Commander Solzhenitsyn, 1944. Notice issued in 1957 by the Military Collegium of the Supreme Court stating that his guilty verdict, under which he spent 8 years in prison and 3 years in exile, is voided, quote, for lack of evidence of a crime, unquote. Nobel Prize diploma and medal. The diploma was painted by the Swedish artist Gunnar Brusewitz, who designed the diploma for Nobel Prize in Literature for many years. The artist is given the freedom to illustrate the laureate's works as he sees them. Brusewitz chose to paint 8 scenes from Solzhenitsyn's books. The diploma also has a page that says in Swedish, the Swedish Academy has decided to award to Alexander Isaevich Solzhenitsyn the Nobel Prize in Literature in 1970 for the ethical force with which he has pursued the indispensable traditions of Russian literature. The Nobel Prize medal for literature was designed in 1902 by the Swedish engraver Erik Lindberg. It is made of 23 karat gold. On one side is shown the Nobel Prize founder, Alfred Nobel. On the other side, a young man sits under a laurel tree and listens to and writes down the song of the muse. The text in Latin is from the Aeneid. Loosely translated, it says, and they who bettered life on earth by their newly found mastery. At the bottom, the text says, Swedish Academy, the name of the laureate, and the year of the prize. Publications. This part of the archive consists of many hundreds of published books by Alexander Solzhenitsyn in many languages. As well as books and articles about the life and works of the writer, commentaries and reviews of his publication. Here is the first USSR edition of One Day in the Life of Ivan Denisovich, Roman Gazeta, 1963. Here are just some of the books published in 2010. And here, 2011, library. On account of the vagaries of his life, Solzhenitsyn never sought to compile a personal library. Nevertheless, our home collection of books number over 5,000 volumes. Among them are many books with marginalia by Solzhenitsyn, not to mention newspapers and journals which he regularly read and made comments on the margins. Here is his favorite four-volume edition of the Dal Dictionary. This is the first edition from 1863, with which he worked for more than 40 years. And here is a collection of poems by Anna Akhmatova, which she gave to Alexander Isaevich with the inscription, "To S. Solzhenitsyn in the days of his glory, Akhmatova, 30th November 1962, Moscow." Library of the Red Wheel. By comparison, this is a library that Alexander Isaevich painstakingly gathered over many years while working on the historical epic. On these shelves is just a smaller part of this library. In addition to books, the archive contains a great many documents, brochures, and Xerox copies of materials relevant to the topic and the times of the Red Wheel. Alexander Isaevich kept them in these large folders grouped by subject. The archive contains several notepads and notebooks in which Solzhenitsyn wrote down the sources which he used. This bibliography of the Red Wheel contains over 2,000 entries. The photo archive is quite large, but there are very few photographs from childhood, youth, and the camp years, for obvious reasons. Here is Solzhenitsyn the boy, 6 years old, 1925. First Lieutenant, 1944. Prisoner, 1946. This is already in Kazakhstan, place of internal exile after the camps. Here is a teacher, Solzhenitsyn, with his students, 1955. Solzhenitsyn took many photographs himself. There is an entire album with 200 photographs he made in the Kazakhstan exile. Here, Solzhenitsyn is receiving the Nobel Diploma and Medal, 1974. And this is already in Vermont at work. Also in Vermont, Lessons with Our Sons, which Alexander Isaevich held regularly. Return to the Homeland, a meeting at one of the train stops. This is his final photograph, summer 2007, at our home in Moscow. The audio archive counts over 100 hours of recordings of Solzhenitsyn reading his works. Of these, 52 hours have been released on 9 CDs. The archive contains a significant number of interviews Solzhenitsyn gave to radio, newspapers, and magazines, radio broadcasts in which he took part, meetings with the reading public, and so on.